Well, good evening, everyone. It's Wednesday night, and that means it's time for the WordCraft podcast. I'm your co-host, Kat Rocha, the night editor, and with me, as always, is...
your co-host, J.Ishiro, author and alien in a human suit, and publisher of many fine graphic novels and novellas, which are all available on Amazon. And if you have not yet bought one, what the hell's wrong with you? Link in the description.
So go check it out. Do it today. You won't regret it.
Well, today we will be hopefully hanging out with a longtime friend of the show, someone we haven't talked to in a while.
Yeah, I'm really excited about this.
Bryan Glass, or J.L. Glass, mm-hmm. The mind behind such titles as MICE TEMPLAR.
Mm-hmm.
And he's done some other very interesting work as well. He apparently had a new book out not too long ago called Furious. Don't know anything about it. Curious to ask him about it.
Yeah.
And he also has written quite a bit for THOR, and he did the Valkyrie miniseries back when that was still good.
Mm-hmm.
So until technical difficulties do resolve themselves, we're just going to hang out and see what's going on.
Yep.
So, okay. We've got 9 people listening. Say something entertaining, Kat.
Do you want me to say something entertaining or naughty? Oh, wait, that's our normal Monday show. Sorry.
Yeah, that's the normal Monday show. I don't know about that. I mean, this is the classy show. This is the one show. Where it's high-minded and intellectual and shit.
The sophisticated show.
The sophisticated show.
Yeah, high culture.
High culture, or at least, well, yeah, well, whatever. I don't know. These days, I don't know what high culture means anymore.
If you know what a book is with actual pages made out of dead trees, then that is high culture.
Yeah, I would agree with that. So, okay. Until our guests arrive, we really do need to talk about something.
Oh, there you go. It's the man of the hour. Hello, Bryan.
Uh-oh. Is this going to be one full of gremlins? Let's see. Does he have the... It appears his microphone is on, but we do not hear Bryan.
Oh, what about? What
there
about?
We go.
There we go. Hey, how you doing, Bryan?
Oh! Is this really me?
I don't know.
I don't know. It could be the mystery caller.
No, because then I would sound like, hello, Art. Is this Area 51? No, that's a whole other topic.
A whole other topic.
Yeah, no, when I say, is it really me? I wanted to know, is it really me on the worldwide interwebs?
Is
this working?
Indeed. Yes. Ah.
Yes.
Oh, anxiety levels coming down by degrees.
Okay. We've run into technical difficulties far, far worse than the guests showing up a few minutes late.
No, we're all good.
This is very minor. So it's been a very long time.
Yes.
It has been years and years.
Oh my God, I can't even remember the last time we saw you.
Early to mid-teens?
Oh my God, has it really been that long?
I think it was Seattle.
Was it Seattle?
Are we literally talking 10 years or more ago?
Oh, dear.
Execute Order 66.
Let me put it this way. At this point, I believe I was still in the midst of a World War Kaiju, and I was still primarily known for Titanium Rain.
I had contributed to Titanium Rain, and I got my awesome audio version. And I remember when I last saw you, you were prepping to release World War Kaiju.
There we go.
Oh,
so
my Lord.
That is a long, long time ago.
Wow! Too long.
Too many oceans crossed since then.
But, you know,
indeed.
You know, I will say to the audience, and I think this bears repeating, oh, God, so was that teens or even before teens?
No, what, it was teens.
It was teens. Early teens.
Yeah.
Bryan said to me, you know, you're really nice in person, and you're a really nice guy. I mean, you just all walked up and offered to help me move all my stuff up to my hotel and help me unpack my booth, or pack up my booth. Online, there's nothing but a nonstop spew of negativity.
Uh-oh.
And you know what? He was right.
Oh.
He was absolutely right. And you know what? You know, it took me a while to get through that hard time, but I've thoroughly limited my social media use, and I am a much happier man.
Yay!
You have done a good deed, sir.
I also have to say, Kat has been relentless in pursuing me to be a guest. And my excuse again and again and again was, oh, well, like, there's really nothing to promote right now. Like, I'll come on and say, oh, yeah, thanks. Hi, I have nothing to talk about. But she has been a trooper. And like, I guess 2022 has been the year that, like, yay, okay, at least, well, there's minor things to talk about.
Oh, that's good.
And you know what? I am legitimately not sure if our audience has read any of your books. And that's the whole point of this show, is to find those new audiences.
Yay. Well, I am pretty certain they've read some of his stuff. They just may not have known it.
Yeah.
Ah, yes, it has been, it feels like it has been eons since anything has literally been published, but there continue to be things produced, like, behind the scenes, as they say.
Well, I know that you've also been very busy in gaming, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, recently, yeah, that has been quite a surprise. I was contacted to develop the backstory world for the Dogami NFT program game. Like, I'm not an NFT guy, and if they had come and asked me to participate in NFTs, I'm like the last guy in the world, but I do know story. And so I was brought aboard, and I developed a huge cosmic backstory to justify their downloadable dogs. And to this yet, as of 2022, I don't know how much of what I created is actually in, like, I'm even reluctant to call it a game. Like, that was one of my glitches, was like, okay, we want a story, but it's about people having fun with their downloadable dogs. So I believe I gave them a really terrific story, and I earned my pay, and I await to see through second parties how much of what I developed for them actually works itself into the game, or into the app, whatever it is.
Very interesting. Well. Since people are slowly arriving, I'm going to do the thing I always say. First off, like and subscribe. You never know if you've been unsubscribed. Mm-hmm. Two, let everyone know we're on the air, because YouTube won't. Mm-hmm. And third, tonight we are talking to a veteran. This man, yes, has been in comics forever, as well as gaming. If you have questions about the craft, this is the man to speak to.
Yes, indeed.
Seriously. He is a well of information. So...
I'm still trapped at the bottom of it. Help someone lower a ladder.
Oh, right now it's such an odd time. Everything's reshuffling itself. It's kind of hard to understand what the new playing field's going to be. Mm-hmm. I think we're all trying to figure that out. So tell, you know what, just so that our audience knows, let's start off with the basics. Who are you, and what should they be reading by you?
Okay, well, first, I found I've been speaking directly into the microphone. So is this an adequate sound? Is this working?
Yeah, you sound great. Mm-hmm.
Oh, Dominic Powell just said, it's been too long since I've read MICE Templar. Nonetheless, I remember enjoying it very much, Mr. Glass. Good to hear you're still working. Thank you, Dominic. Yes, MICE Templar is very near and dear to my heart. But to get back to the intro, I am Bryan J.L. Glass. The thing for which I am most notable for in the comic industry is I co-created the MICE Templar with Mike Oeming. And then later we brought aboard Victor Santos. And Victor Santos, we credited him as being a co-creator because he ended up doing about 75% of the actual art. And so many of the locations as the story grew, like it starts very much like a very small scale medieval type hero's journey. But as the story progresses, the scale gets bigger and bigger. The past gets bigger and bigger. The cosmology gets larger and larger and more cosmic. And Victor ended up being the guy who took the original design reins from Mike Oeming. And it was Victor who designed later all of our more elaborate set pieces. And midway through the seven volumes, me and Mike had a discussion and we just felt Victor is not just work for hire. We have to make him a full partner. And so Mice Templar is now created by Glass, Oeming, and Santos.
That's awesome. And how many volumes are out so far?
Well, volume versus actual physical book in hand, which is considered a volume. There are seven books in what I now call five volumes. And even the five volumes is a bit sketchy. To me, a volume completed a story arc idea. And is this like a good place to just like go off on?
Hey,
like,
yeah. Talk about
stuff.
And by the way, everyone, if any of this interests you, I've got a link in the description to Bryan's books on Amazon.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Yeah. So initially, it all began with Mike Oeming had a very short. Well, he had a 6-issue miniseries idea that told a traditional, very rote, by the book, by the numbers, hero's journey adventure that would tell one character's entire lifetime within the hero's journey saga within 6 issues. And it was the Mice Templar, and he originally proposed it literally back in 1997. And I know this created much controversy later when the series debuted, and we ended up coming out within a year simultaneous with David Peterson's excellent Mouse Guard.
Mm-hmm.
And literally the two books, they share medieval mice in common. Once you get past medieval mice, they are nothing alike whatsoever.
I would go so far as to say they're also definitely for different age groups.
Yeah, and that's no slight or detriment on either side. But we were definitely going for, we wanted to do these very hard. Well, originally Mike wanted to do very hardcore mice that didn't shy away from beheading other mice if it was a civil war. And so I was brought aboard. Well, he was originally pitching it very, very early, but he himself was not confident as being an independent storyteller at the time. And it was in 2002, he presented to me that he was going to return to Mice Templar. He wanted to release it. And I was like, oh, I congratulated him. Oh, this is so cool. This is one of your neatest ideas. And he said, but I really don't know what I'm doing as a storyteller yet. And he asked me, would I come aboard? And his words were literally, I've quoted this many times. He said, Bryan, I need you to build me a world and make it resonate. And a past and a cosmology that resonates with the story being told has always been my primary driving force. Like I hate the fantasy story where, oh, the hero goes into a cave as if he's on a D&D adventure, and he finds the magic sword that proceeds to change his destiny. And like, So what you're saying is cosmically, it was all just this random chance. You stumbled upon the right cave with the right sword, and you were the right vehicle to brandish its power. And on from that moment launches your tale. I'm a far bigger guy. I like seeing the cosmic view of things. And so if your hero is going to find the item, if his finding it is not a cosmic destiny, the item that he finds has a whole history before he ever ends up finding it. And your story is richer if the magic thing that your hero finds resonates with the rest of the history in the tale. I believe Tolkien's Lord of the Rings falls into that, because as a slight segue, Bilbo finding the ring, it seems very much a chance encounter in The Hobbit, but as he ultimately expounded upon his tale, he got to revise backwards and reveal that, oh no, the ring had a mind of its own and it was looking to get back to a master. And suddenly Bilbo is just the vehicle that transports the item of power to a larger destiny and thus creates the foundation upon which all of the Lord of the Rings resides. So that's kind of the approach that I bring to storytelling. So when Mike said, build me a world and make it resonate, he knew that about me, and that's what he wanted out of his very, very generic fantasy hero's journey version of Mice Templar. And so he proceeded to send me all of his materials, everything he had created, what the 6-issue story arc was. And he said, take or dispose of any of this as you see fit. Like, just whatever you think is of value, keep, meld it, manipulate it, do whatever you want to do. And so I, of course, was incredibly honored. So I entered in with the mindset of, how can I honor as much of what Mike created as possible? It may not appear as Mike intended it to appear, but I'm going to find a way to make all of his random magic actually work cohesively. There were references to like just throwaway mythology. And I went, how can I take Mike's throwaway mythology and actually weave it in to the main narrative? And next thing I knew, to Mike's great distress, I had turned his 6-issue miniseries into what I considered to be like a 3-volume trilogy epic that ultimately became 4 volumes. And so bringing it full circle back to the question that led all into this, what I call a volume is kind of an act of the story. So we did act 1 with Mike. It's the first 6 issues. And it was very much the opening heroic hero's journey. It was the origin Mike initially wanted. It's the young hero, he's in the village, the bad guys attack and burn it. It's very ElfQuest, it's very Conan the Barbarian, the movie, the bad guys come and burn the village, and it's how a million of these stories have begun. And I actually argued with him that could we do an entire arc before the village gets burned? And he was like, no, the village has to be destroyed by the end of issue 1. So I did my best to work in all of the idea, like seeded the ideas that would be expanded upon over the course of what became 4 to 5 quote volumes. Everything is embedded, even in some throwaway lines, within that opening arc. And then at the end of that arc, well, Mike had committed himself to doing his 6 issues. He did his 6 issues. he had his trade paperback. He was ready to be done. But I still had an epic to tell. And so he brought aboard a Spanish artist, Victor Santos, and just said, like, Victor is hungry. He's ready to mimic my style. He will do whatever you need. And Victor ended up becoming the savior of MICE Templar. He is the guy that allowed all the various volumes to ultimately come out. But where we stumbled into the problem of five arcs versus seven books was halfway through. Oh, there it is, Destiny. That was the debut of Victor's art. And you'll literally watch Victor improve issue by issue by issue. He ended up like, he was amazing. And he became a really good friend in the process. But halfway through, we felt we had lost some momentum. And I'm guilty of being the guy who simply said, how about we do volume 2.1? We will do half of the second arc as a volume. And then we'll do the conclusion. And like, I have lived to regret that decision for... There's nothing worse than, ooh, I got a volume, and it's all about raising all the questions. Oh, you have to buy volume 2 for the finale. And I've hated that. And then volume 3 came along, and it's this thick, this big-ass, thick, big white volume, 9 issues or 8 issues, and the 8th is double-sized, and it's just, it's huge. And I think some of my best writing in that is in that. Victor's incredible art is in that. And it marked the midpoint of the story. And then we got the final arc was supposed to be Legend. And all right, well, it's going to be in 2 collections, but this time I've learned my lesson. I'm going to design each arc to build to at least a book's conclusion. And then we continue the idea of our hero as a legend. Oh! And
hey, that looks familiar.
Yes, it is. It's the marvelous Mr. Finney's piece that accompanied the Gail Simone forward, I believe, in Destiny 2.2.
That was a lot of fun to do.
And your turnaround was phenomenal. We expressed a need, and it was like 48 hours later. Oh my God, here's this amazing piece of work. And we were really, really honored to have you within the book, which may explain why I am here on this show. So the climactic 4th volume, I suddenly realized, oh my goodness, this just gets bigger and bigger and bigger. We're going to have to break it into 3 collections. And then when the time came for the 3rd collection to start as issues, Eric Stevenson, our long-suffering editor, publisher at Image, he said, you're not coming back from a 6-month hiatus with issue number 19. And so he forced us to turn the climax of Legend into a 5th volume, Night's End. And the irony of Night's End is that it literally takes place within 20, the entire volume is 24 hours. But it was intended to be the conclusion to the Legend arc. So to bring this whole meandering tale to a close, and I thank you if you're still listening to my babbling on and on and on, is that a 4-volume, a 4-arc series be turned into 7 actual collected volumes. Whew! There I go. All right, I'm done. You say I can
talk. Well, here, I'll throw this out there. Okay, you guys have been asking for a long time. You guys saying you've been asking about fantasy? You've been asking about good art, and you wanted a series. 7 volumes, guys. It's all done. It's all available on Amazon in hardbound. And as you can see, the quality is top-notch. So there you go.
And I have a question, because this has come up in other episodes and other conversations. You were talking about how, you know, how it 6-issue miniseries turned into, you know, 7 volumes. Do you consider this one of those stories that's kind of run away with you? Or is like, no, you had the reins on the entire time. It just grew.
I had the reins on the whole time. I'm a very, very big believer in when you embark upon a tale, at least thematically, you need to know where it's ending. I think over the course, dare I say, pre the 21st century, people were less concerned about, like, television history is filled with series that, well, it ran one season, and then, oh, look, it ended. And like, oh, you could tell, like, all these shows end on these cliffhangers because they believe they were going to get a second season. Mm-hmm. And it really wasn't until we crossed that year 2000 threshold that I think certain storytelling sensibilities kicked in. And that idea, like, we still get series that just get randomly canceled and we really don't get the ending that we were promised or intended. And then at the same time, you get shows that, oh my goodness, in retrospect, you can tell they reinvent themselves 3, 4, sometimes 5 times to literally become a completely different show than the series that they began as. And I'm intentionally avoiding name dropping anything because everything is ultimately somebody's favorite show. And I'm not here to besmirch anybody's favorite shows. But another phenomena was these cultivated epic sagas where the audience was promised fulfilling endings. And you get to those endings. And again, like, we can all, like, we all have shows that come to mind, and I'm not going to name drop any of them. What is the age range for MICE Templar? I would often tell I would open up volume 2 and I would show parents who would ask me, and it's a series where one brother during a civil war puts a knife blade through his fellow brother's throat. But then it's not just glorifying the violence. The series then, that character lived with the consequences of what he had done. So while the MICE Templar is incredibly violent at times, the violence is never gratuitous. I'm sure there's people that will argue that, but the violence and the brutality always, to me, serve the purposes of the story. In general, I would tell people that it's a PG-13, but then I would have parents that I would show that spread to, and what I would hear more often than not was, oh, my child plays video games that are more violent than that. So ultimately, I would say it comes down to the parent knowing the child. It is full of violence. It is not full of mouse nudity or gratuitous sex, or no sex for that matter. You know, it happens because mice populate like mice.
Yes.
But the series is not about that. But it does deal with themes of oppression and violence, revolution, tyranny, but all of the characters deal with the consequences of their actions. it's very much a series that deals with consequences. So I've also been faced with, because it took so long for the series to come out, kids who were 10 to 12 years old when the series started, who then came to me when they were in college, when the series ended, and they would extol how, as a kid, their parents bought it for them. They loved it on one level. Ooh, yeah, it was violent, and had all these titillating, exciting action scenes, and there was blood and beheadings. And then as they got older, they would go back and reread it, and they would begin to realize all of the subtexts within the tale that they completely missed as a child. And it actually made them love it more the older that they got. So, man, I just segued off into the deep end there.
We've recently had that experience with quite a few things, haven't we? Mm-hmm.
Please, yeah, please, I've been doing all the blabbing.
Oh, no.
This show is all about you, sir.
People are really enjoying this. What I will say about MICE Templar, and I think your work in general, which when you were saying, yeah, there's violence in it, but, and I would say really just to make it very simple, there's a moral underpinning to the entire story. There's moral framework to all of this, which is, I think, what is so different than what we get a lot of right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I that was the intent going in. I ultimately wanted to tell ultimately a very uplifting, inspiring story. But again, as Tolkien played out through the character of Frodo, sometimes the salvation of the world takes its toll upon the hero. Even if the hero doesn't have the big moment of the dramatic sacrifice that, oh, my sacrifice has changed everything for all humanity. It's, wow, the victory came at a price. The victory took a toll. And that I have always felt is a very, very human. It's a very deep-rooted, human, realistic trait. And I want to tell stories that, while not, like, I'm not a humanistic writer. I do come from a faith background. I do not proselytize through any of my work. But I do want my work to hopefully touch people on whatever spiritual level that they're at. I'm not there to indoctrinate where I'm coming from. But if at any point your own humanism takes on a more transcendent level, hopefully I'm telling a tale that touches something within that transcendent experience. And so I want to tell a story that is both grim and gritty in the absolute human depravity that we all exist in, while at the same time shows you can aspire to arise out of that muck. There is something there, let me just call it an ideal. There are ideals worth reaching up and outward for. And sometimes achieving those ideals can come at the cost of our tangible. I hope that made some kind of sense.
Oh, no, that made absolute sense. Mm-hmm. I mean, we won't go down this path too far, but I've repeated over and over on this show that the one thing that I think a lot of people are learning right now is that, you know, faith or no faith, the basis of our morals do come from essentially Christian innovations. The Enlightenment would have never happened. The idea of Western values would have never happened. So, I mean, there are universal values that it doesn't matter where you're coming from, is that we can all understand. Mm-hmm. And when you write values rather than, I guess, politics or ideology, everybody can, like Star Wars, everybody can relate to those early films, the mm-hmm. first three. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Those values are universal.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly.
Okay. We had some questions here. Should we pop them up?
Sure.
first, please, and then we'll get to Furious because somebody has asked about that.
Ah, yes.
And I'm curious about that too.
This is from Dominic Powell.
Oh, I don't know if we should go down this path. If you don't want to answer this, go ahead and say so.
Oh, no, I'm good. I'm good.
Okay, read it.
Okay. Mr. Glass, what got you into writing and how did you get attached to writing Valkyrie before Marvel Comics decided to bastardize her?
The laughter is for the secondary question. What got me into writing is like, oh my goodness, I could go off and I could take over a half hour of this show before I ever even get to Valkyrie. So I'm just going to skip that for the here and now. If the show warrants it, I'll happily return to that question in one form or another. But how I got the chance to write Valkyrie, and I can tell both the personally, the good and the bad of that experience, and the bad had nothing to do with Marvel. I got the Valkyrie experience, or not the experience, I got the Valkyrie opportunity specifically because I had won a Harvey Award for writing the MICE Templar. And that's what made Marvel begin to pay attention to me. But I was immediately, there she is. Oh, I love that cover. Oh, the artist right now. I'm friends with him on Facebook, and it kills me that I can't go, oh, yes, that is so-and-so's work. But he did awesome, awesome work. He also did all the covers for my Thor First Thunder miniseries. But he is an awesome talent, and that Valkyrie cover deserved a better story. I got the story because I had won the Harvey Award for the MICE Templar, and I was designated as, quote, the fantasy guy. So if Marvel was going to hire me, I appeared like I was a hot commodity at the time. And a lot of who gets hired and who gets fired is based on impressions of you as a commodity. So as long as your commodity is hot, they'll hire you. The moment there's any diminishment of that commodity, okay, they move on and they grab the next bright light. That's the sad reality of corporate comics. But mm-hmm. I got given the opportunity, like I received the phone call, or I got the email, which led to the phone call. It was on either a Thursday or a Friday, and it was literally, by Monday, you need to have a pitch. And I had been a Valkyrie fan as far as I'd been a fan of the Defenders, both the early Steve Gerber era, and then I particularly really enjoyed the J.M. DeMatteis era of the series. And I had made one attempt at one of the Valkyrie miniseries, and I just felt, like, okay, who's ever writing this? I don't know the names. I'm sorry if I'm disparaging them. I felt, again, there may have been some editorial effort involved to estrange the character from her origins. But at her base, Valkyrie, and I gave an officially endorsed interview at the time, where I literally decreed my intro to Marvel was I had one weekend to tell the definitive Valkyrie story for the Marvel Universe's most complicated and complex character of all time. And like, oh! And so like I agonized, and the pitch that I presented would have actually made a somewhat decent two-issue miniseries or a double-sized Valkyrie issue. But they, at that point in time, they needed it all within 22 pages. And so
that's impossible.
Yeah, and it was like this plot line had to go and that plot line had to go. And my editor at the time, Bill Rosenman, he was a champ. He's the guy that hired me. He's currently working for their gaming division right now. But he was a sweetheart, and he just he gently let me know, like, yeah, this won't fly and that won't fly. And it wasn't about content, it was about like just the size. And I had turned Mike Oeming's 6-issue miniseries into a 7-volume epic. So, oh, I have 22 pages to tell the definitive Valkyrie story. And I tried really, really hard. And what truly makes it's called tragic opera, because the whole Divakur, the whole ring cycle by Wagner is the epitome of the tragic opera. It's the Götterdämmerung, the twilight of the gods, ultimately. And that's what I wanted to play with thematically, by invoking, like, okay, let me go back to the source of Valkyrie. Oh, there she is, tragic opera. And there she is, dangling. She's about to fall to her death. And so I came up with a storyline that tried to play on themes of death and rebirth. J.M. Straczynski had just resurrected Thor, and so I wanted to play with that. And the fact that Valkyrie was even back in the game at all was because she had been randomly chosen by Ed Brubaker when, I think it was it Secret Avengers? It was one of the it was one of the multiplex of you pay your money and, oh, what movie am I going to go see within the multiplex? It was, they were all Avengers. There were anti-Avengers and Secret Avengers and my old Aunt Millie's Avengers and Avengers After Dark. And but he, Ed Brubaker, he was the hotshot Captain America guy at the time, who had found the way to bring Bucky back as the Winter Soldier, reinvented Catwoman at DC in a really terrific way. So he got a chance to do an Avengers title, to bring in all these disparate characters, and he wanted Valkyrie. And he had the clout to say, I don't care about her continuity. I want a Norse god person, even though technically as a Valkyrie, she is not one of the Valhallan. The terms are escaping me right now. But so that was why Valkyrie was back in the Marvel Universe, because Ed Brubaker wanted her in, and I believe it was Secret Avengers. Someone with more knowledge than me can correct me on that, or say, yes, you're absolutely correct. But I got assigned Valkyrie. And so, all right, let me go back to the origins. And Straczynski's given us this this rebirth from death concept. And what is the Valkyrie's whole idea? She brings the spirits of the departed. But then there needed to be a villain. And I feel the weakest part of the story is that the villain just ends up being a generic member of the Wrecking Crew. And like, yawn. On the pages you have up right now, the zack kaboom! I wrote that. I typed zack kaboom! Yes. Nothing is better than writing sound effects when they look awesome. When they look terrible, you say, oh yeah, that was the letterer. No. The sound, whatever sound effects you see have no impact on the editor at all. It all comes down to that poor editor or that poor writer typing, by Odin's blood. forsooth, verily, and forsooth. And so it was literally, I submitted it by the Friday deadline. Like, I submitted the proposal on Monday. He gave me 24 hours to revamp it, and then the whole issue was due by Friday.
God,
and, And it was like, oh my God, everything I knew about Valkyrie just vanished from my head other than like the big beat points. And there's a fan, and maybe he's even listening, and he can take a pat on the back right now. I have a scene in this where she crosses paths with Janet Van Dyne, the Wasp. And it was post all the, oh, Henry Pym smacking her and getting divorced and blah, blah, blah. And I just, why did I put Janet Van Dyne? Because I love the Wasp. I loved Janet Van Dyne's The Wasp. And because she was in one issue, a member of the Valkyries, like Lady Liberties or whatever they were called. There was an issue where like Valkyrie led a team of female, like, oh, we're all empowered and we're going to, like, they struck down their male oppressors. And like, there was
I remember that infamous issue where it was actually a parody of 70s women's lib.
Yes.
I remember that.
Yep. And so that was the only correlation I could find. And because I love the Wasp, and I went, this is my first Marvel opportunity. I want to write the Wasp. And I did, I think, 3 pages where she crosses paths, like, because she's been reborn. She's stumbling around. Her blouse is open, not for any sexual purposes. My intent in writing it was, it's because that's the last thing on her mind. The paramedic who revived her ripped open the blouse, put the pads, brought her back to, like, resuscitated her, restored the Valkyrie spirit in her, and the last thing on her mind is to fix her clothing. So she goes through half the issue until she dons her uniform again. And my intent as I was writing it was, it's because in her mindset, it doesn't matter to her. And as she's wandering around trying to find out, like, who am I? Who was I? She stumbles upon the Wasp. And I thought, oh, here's my chance to play with how the Wasp had her period of, this is who I am, this event occurred, and then the event forced me to determine what my own new identity was. And I thought, that's going to be my impetus for Valkyrie. And then this fan came up to me at a convention, and he was a huge Valkyrie fan, and he just said, everything you did with Janet Van Dyne the Wasp, you could have done with Hellcat, because Hellcat had also married Damien, son of Satan. It had become abusive. And I just, the only response I could give to him was, you're 100% correct. And if I had had more than a weekend to conjure my story and do a bit more research, I may have gone that route, the route that ultimately could be argued I should have gone. But bringing it back full circle, I submitted the final script on Friday. They accepted it with, like, incredibly minor, like, oh, can you tweak this, tweak that? But it was after it was done, this whole other idea of her villain, instead of being just another generic member of Thor's villains, the Wrecker and his wrecking crew. I could have done a whole thing where her villain was actually another Asgardian, and the Ragnarok that had necessitated J.M. Straczynski's resuscitation of Thor, and then Thor resuscitating all the other gods to remake Asgard on Earth. It could have been the villain could have been an unrequited, abusive Asgardian that couldn't accept that a mere Valkyrie had rebuffed her. And so now that they're all living these, like, they haven't been awakened yet, but they're living these new lives. He has set out to murder her. And like that thought hit me, and I contacted the editor and I went, oh my God, please, can I revise the second half of the story? I have a much better ending. And he went, maybe next time, because it had entered the machine already. So that's my Valkyrie story. How that happened, I really wanted to honor the character. There's a two-page montage towards the end of the book where she's facing death again, and she literally relives her entire history. And I was really proud of those two pages, but I also felt those two pages emphasized just how impossible coming up with the ultimate Valkyrie story in 4 days was. And I went, this is my one and only shot to do something. And that's it. That's the tale.
You know, not nearly as mind-racking or as nerve
epic.
Yeah. But you remember our Catwoman job where it was kind of like, you've got 3 weeks.
Well, we weren't even writing it.
Yeah, no, we were to illustrate.
Yeah. It's like
three weeks. Fully painted.
I remember that. It was a beautiful looking book.
Oh, thank you. But yeah, that
I slept so much after those 3 weeks.
Okay, we have
let's talk a little bit about Furious. Or do you want to you're the host.
Well,
I'm your co-host.
Well, you've already brought it up. So Undead Quinn just made the comment of I loved his Furious series.
Tell us about Furious.
Oh, thank you, Undead Quinn, so much. Yes, I can talk about Furious. I can talk about the lows and the highs, and then the lows and the highs, and then I can end with the lows. Who knows at this point? Let me ask my hosts. How much about Furious do you really want to know?
You know, I think we're going to go late on this show. Yeah. Usually this show's only an hour, but go ahead.
Yes.
Tell us on it.
Okay. So
I see you did this with Victor Santos.
Yes, I did. And he stepped up. He did a phenomenal job. He was not my vision of the artistry that I would have, that I imagined for this book. But when the opportunity arose, I am enamored of the work that he did. And I have willingly attached him as co-creator of the series. And so whatever becomes of her going forward, Victor will always be listed as co-creator of Furious. The origin of Furious literally goes back to 1988 to 89, believe it or not.
Wow. Okay.
Ancient history. So I've relayed this in other interviews. I will try to truncate this as concise as possible. The original origin of Furious is because I was privy to Frank Miller's Daredevil as they were coming out as issues. And I would, very excitedly wait the 30 days for the next issue of Daredevil. And this was all during the Elektra saga and his battles with Kingpin and all of that stuff that kind of fundamentally reinvented Daredevil. And then Frank Miller left and he went to DC and he reinvented Batman with The Dark Knight Returns. Ooh, that was a difficult page to write. And I debated whether or not to even have that in the story, but I felt the beating she lays down later required that page be that you needed to know why the villain was getting the crap beat out of them. So, all right. Blah, 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 blah. So Frank Miller, he reinvented Daredevil. Then he went and he resuscitated Batman as the Dark Knight Returns. And like the 80s was the era of Frank Miller. Whatever he touched became gold. And when Marvel finally got him to come back and return to Daredevil, he did an 8-issue arc entitled Born Again. And what he
remember that.
Yeah.
That was so good.
And that, in the grand scheme of all comics, like there have been better comics since then, but as far as comics that really hit me where I lived, that was the miniseries that defined comic book storytelling for me. In 8 issues, he took a beloved, established hero, totally deconstructed them, brought them down to their base level, and then gave them a new reason for living, and in essence, rebirth, reborn. And then gave them a triumphant ending. And it wasn't, oh, look at that, I saved the cosmos. We killed Thanos. We brought all the dead people back. It wasn't Endgame. It was, he did it all, and he saved the woman he had loved in his youth, who had become a drug addict, and he was there to save her. And
I'm going to interrupt just real quickly. I think you bringing that up about Born Again with Daredevil,
mm-hmm.
is I miss that. It seems like everything now, it has to be, you know, the universe is going to blow up, the world's going to blow up. You know, evil, it just these incredibly gigantic plots to the point where it's like, I'm not really relating to this.
Yeah.
When something as simple as losing a loved one is far more impactful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep. And it's that, you want to do the grand epic operatic saga about things that are very, like, to me, comic books at their best are grand opera about very intimate things. And I guess that's my quote for the show.
That was Gene Roddenberry said about the original Star Trek, which I think is why it's still superior to the Next Generation, is the original Star Trek were morality plays, every single one of them.
Mm, I'd agree with that.
And that resonates.
Yeah.
But anyway, continue.
Okay, yeah. So that story so moved me. And like the early creators, we always strive to recreate that which we know, that which influenced us. It's why every...
compliment here.
Thank you, Trenton. Yes, I'm honored. Thank you very, very much.
Trenton's a really good guy.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Follow me, Facebook, Twitter, the whole shebang. I'm there.
All in the description. The links are there.
Fantastic. Yeah. So there's a reason, like, every aspiring creator starts off creating their own superhero team, and their own superhero team almost always invariably contains an alien who grew up on Earth, and a grim and gritty dark vigilante, and some type of Amazonian woman, and a patriotic guy, and a guy in armor, and a, dare I call it, a hulking rage monster, and a speedster, and you have to have an archer, and ultimately everyone has a guy who's very feral with claws. And it's not the Justice League, and they're not Avengers, and the Claw Guy isn't Wolverine. But that's what everybody creates, because they are all the foundational archetype. Oh, I forgot the underwater guy. Be he Aquaman or Namor, there's always an underwater guy, too. And up until just a few years ago, the underwater guy used to be the butt of all the jokes. But thank you, Jason Momoa. You made the underwater guy cool.
Namor was always cool, though.
Yes, yes, I agree. That's because he was the impassioned Mr. Spock, and he was just like, you humans, I'm shaking a finger at you.
He was the bad boy.
Yeah. So, all right, man, this is already taking longer than I intended. So,
go ahead. Yeah, doesn't matter.
So I read Born Again, and I'm like, oh my goodness. If I was ever to break into comics, I want to do my version. I want to put my spin on the Born Again storyline. And so I ended up, I looked at Marvel and I went, who is the Marvel character who would be the most unexpected to be revealed as having this incredible dark side who could be ripped down to their foundations and then reborn as somebody brand new? And because I was a fan of Janet Van Dyne, the Wasp, I created this Wasp story where, in essence, the Wasp received the Daredevil Born Again treatment. And I wrote a miniseries, and I attempted to pitch it, and I had never written a comic book in my life, so there was no way in the world that this unknown guy with no experience whatsoever was ever going to legitimately pitch anything to Marvel Comics. But damn it, I tried. And after, like, that, nothing came of it. We entered the early 90s, and the late 80s into the early 90s, there was this big boom in independent comics that was called the black and white explosion. And there were all these, like, these black and white projects, and that's where Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles were born up out of. They were probably the quintessential success story of the black and white boom. And so I connected with another artist, and I said, well, I can't do the Wasp, but I still love the story I created. So let me create a saga where the purpose of the series both builds a universe, builds the heroine, while simultaneously deconstructing her. And next thing I knew, I was essentially creating a, not in quality, but in scope, a Watchmen level thing. Like for the story of Watchmen to unfold, it needed its own universe. It's not set in the DC universe proper. Every hero needs an introduction, needs an origin. And next thing I knew, to tell my heroine's very simple, well, simple in context, to tell about her deconstruction and ultimate renewal, I had to also tell the story of a Marvel or DC level universe that also had other heroes. And like, next thing I knew, it was just getting bigger all the time. Like, 8 issues wasn't enough. 10 issues wasn't enough. And I went, oh my God, like, I have become the guy who is pitching his version of the Justice League, his version of the Avengers. Oh, look, there's the patriotic guy. Hell, look, there's the God on Earth. Hey, look, there's the guy in armor. No. And just realizing no one is going to care about the story I'm trying to tell because it's going to get lost in the creation of the universe itself. Hey, Neostar, thank you very much. Neostar Productions, thank you for that compliment very, very much. And so that version, that reinvention of the character just kind of collapsed. And I went like, well, the story that I want to tell that I still haven't told, not even in the Furious volume, it went into limbo for almost 20 years. And I effectively, my approach to it was, I need a hook that is unique enough, and I don't know what that hook is. But until that hook comes, I can't tell her story without also telling the story of a superhero universe. And no one cares, really, if you want to be honest, no one cares about your version of Justice League. If they've got the Justice League, why do they need yours? I don't mean to be a downer. There's a certain
Go ahead. I will say though, I will say what you've just said there, why would anyone want the discount version or the second rate Avengers or Justice League when there's already the Avengers or Justice League?
Mm-hmm.
And I would say until 2020 maybe or 2019, that was true.
I know where you're going. Please. Yeah.
Now the door is open to replace them because they don't exist anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. I would say back when I was battling this, the case was that both of those teams are being well served. And as long as they're being well served, why do we want to invest money or, more importantly, time to consume your regurgitation of something else? And that's why the only versions that would ultimately kind of prove successful, like The Watchmen, like The Boys, they were always the we're going to reflect the dark mirror. It's the dark mirror reflection of the heroes you thought you knew. So it needed to be some form of reinvention or look at your traditional heroes through a different filter in order for these new versions to become successful in the larger public sphere. This was, of course, all pre-internet for the most part, pre-social media. Now we're definitely living in a new era for both good and bad. And so there is now room for the reinterpretations to take place. But back when I was like anguishing over how can I tell this born again story, and I can't without also telling a story of a superhero universe, and who cares about my version of it? What am I going to add within if I'm telling her story, any story of a universe is therefore subtext. It's in the background. And how can I make the background universe as meaningful as the primary story being told, but the primary story needs its foundation? And I didn't want to just, Here's my Marvel U. Here's my DCU. No, I don't want to do that. I have no interest in compromising myself creatively that way. And so it just languished. And the impetus, and sorry, this did go on way beyond more than I wanted to say. What ended up, sadly, being the impetus, what changed my original WASP born again storyline beyond the self-created 1990s version that would have been a black and white in its own universe was sadly the death of Whitney Houston. And I'm of an age, like I was never a fan of Whitney Houston. I respected her as a performer. But I'm also old enough to remember when her first video debuted on MTV, and she was this young, I don't know if she was still teenaged or if she was early 20s, she did this. I can't even tell you what the song was, but she just had this bubbly, effusive, here's her debut song, here's her debut video, and she's going to be a big star. And then over the course of the next 30 years, we watched her disintegrate before our eyes. And she got her chance to be in movies opposite Denzel Washington. She continued to come out and, all right, here's my next album. But when she wasn't making news for her music, she was making news for her next, the next step in her disintegration. And it was tragic. And I also remember that she was the niece of Dionne Warwick. And it always struck me, where was Dionne Warwick as all this was happening? Was she talking to her Psychic Friends Network? Or that might be dating me.
I remember that. She was up there with Miss Cleo, but anyway.
Yep. And I remember, okay, so Whitney passed away through drug addiction. And then all these stars came out, and it ended up being Patton Oswalt. He tweeted something, and I'm not going to be able to quote it. I'm calling it from memory. But he called out all the stars saying, she self-destructed before our eyes. And now you're all bemoaning the tragedy of her loss. And he called them all out as hypocrites without using the word. And it struck me. I went, she's a product of my era. I watched this. I wasn't really a fan, but wow, did that statement resonate? And it was a few days later, I went back to my wife and I said, this is really awful, but what if instead of telling the story of a superhero who's a star as a superhero gets the born again treatment, disintegrates, and then has to resuscitate with all the baggage attached? What if I replace a world, a universe of superheroes with a world of superstardom? No one needs to understand the DCU and all its history. No one needs to understand the MCU, its movie version, its comic version, all the convoluted versions. Everyone recognizes the star and the deconstruction of the star via social media. The star who falls literally before our eyes. Oh, and we all loved her when she was young and bubbly. We loved the child star. We loved Lindsay Lohan. And then we watched her disintegrate over a span of 10 years. Thankfully, I've recently learned apparently she's getting remarried and hopefully she's getting her life back on track. But for that period of time, she was the Disney girl. And then she disintegrated. And then you can take any number of old TV child stars, of up-and-coming music stars. We now have rap stars who die tragically or who get murdered. And I just went, so let's forget superheroes. She's not a superhero. She's a media star that everybody loved. And we're going to destroy her in a fashion everybody recognizes. And instead of the story being about her deconstruction, I'm going to reinvent the born-again storyline to be, here's the train wreck who is trying to resuscitate herself. And thus the premise of Furious is, child star gone horribly wrong, degenerates into alcohol and drug addiction, disintegrates before the public eye. And then at her lowest, she receives an experimental drug rehab treatment that literally purges her of all her addictions, but also leaves her with these slowly evolving superpowers. And if the series had been able to continue, there are secrets to how her superpowers actually work. And they would steadily, slowly evolve over time, following an actual predetermined path. But her dilemma is, oh my God, everybody effectively hates me. But now I'm a superhero. As an actress, I'm going to put on a costume. I'm going to play the role of superheroine. And there's no script. There's no director. I'm going to try to give people what I think they want in a superheroine. And I have superpowers to back it up. But deep down, she does still have all that negative baggage, everything that made her self-destruct. Only now she can't blame it on the alcohol. She can't blame it on the drugs. She can't blame it on the fame and the notoriety. Suddenly it's just her and superpowers. And if she doesn't like how you're messing with her case, oh my God, now instead of just punching the paparazzi, she can kill somebody. And suddenly her noble intention of reinventing herself as the beacon so that her light might shine and influence all others. A local newscast captures her being violent on film and dubs her Furious. And that becomes the name that sticks. So she's right back to, oh my God, instead of the media starlet, I'm now the superheroine starlet. And am I allowing the media to control me? Or do I have to restrain myself in order to then take control of who I am, how I'm presented? And ultimately, I felt within these opening five issues, me and Victor told a very heroically affirming redemption story that was only scratching the surface of the universe that I intended to build.
And that sounds like one hell of a story, Bryan. Is there any chance that you could like maybe take this to Indiegogo or Kickstarter and bring it back?
Well, at the time that it was accepted at Dark Horse, and this is my understanding of the events that took place. When we got accepted, it was shortly after the Disney buyout of Luke, or the sale of Lucasfilm to Disney took place. And everyone immediately went, oh, so it's only a matter of time. If Disney already owns Marvel, it's only going to be a matter of time. As soon as Dark Horse Comics contract with producing Star Wars comics ends, Marvel is going to pull all that material back, and then any future Star Wars comics are going to come out of Marvel Comics, which is exactly what ended up happening. But in 2013, when Furious was proposed and then accepted, Dark Horse was suddenly, to my understanding, was looking at Star Wars represents 40% of our market share in the comic industry. And we're going to be losing that within a set period of time. And someone at Dark Horse thought that, well, what's really hot right now are creator-owned comics, like at Image, because Walking Dead was just debuting, and Saga was a big, big deal, and Image was getting all of the attention. And so they thought, well, Dark Horse will reinvent itself as Image. And so I wasn't, even though I was producing an Image comic at the time in the MICE Templar, I was not considered an A-list top-tier Image creator. So Dark Horse was thrilled to kind of get a second tier or a lower tier Image guy. And Victor was drawing MICE Templar at the time. So it really opened up the door for me and Victor to produce the series. And the series ended up doing really, really well. But the reason, again, to my understanding, how it was explained to me, the reason it got canceled was not because the book itself wasn't successful. It was because the entire creator-owned line at Dark Horse was intended to fill the 40% Star Wars void. And when it failed to fulfill that void, because a bunch of second-tier creators aren't going to replace Knights of the Old Republic and all the other everything else. We're not going to fulfill 40%. And so the decision was, unless there was one huge, gigantic, breakaway, undeniable hit, cancel the whole line.
They wanted a Walking Dead to pop out of this.
Yes. And okay. So regardless of how well Furious did, it didn't fulfill what the bean counters wanted. And so we weren't individually canceled. We were canceled along with a slew of titles. And like, okay, so I've got this book and Victor is anxious to do more. And we started shopping around. And what we rammed into was then publishers saying, why would we take on a book that failed at Dark Horse? And then it was, well, it didn't fail at Dark Horse. Were you canceled at Dark Horse? What? Yes, but there were extended. We don't care. But Star Wars, Disney, the buyout, Marvel. And it didn't matter. And so we found ourselves in 2015 with, all right, well, we have 5 issues. We have a trade. We have this book that, to my knowledge, no one has ever communicated to me and said, oh, that book sucked. And I have this huge following that, oh, my God, we want more. And all I've been able to tell them is, oh, my God, I have 7 volumes of her. I have a saga for her that I would love, and nothing was able to happen. And I said this saga went up and down and up and down. We ended up connecting, I think it was 2017, with an indie comic company. Another guy who was publishing through them. He was a fan of mine on Facebook, and when he was following various postings that I would do, like, well, we pitched Furious again, it didn't land anywhere, and we had this opportunity where a brand new company, I guess this was our 2016 tale, a brand new company was going to build itself around, like, I both trusted and really loved the guy who was going to bankroll it all. And he was proposing, I'm going to build a brand new comic company, but I'm going to build it around Bryan J.L. Glass's Furious. And that lasted for about 6 months. And then he got beset by some company and business difficulties. And so I ended up, like, I went on Facebook from reporting, like, here's the exciting saga of how Furious is coming back. And here we are at Emerald City Comic Con, and I'm shopping for the new artist. And, oh, here we are at Chicago Comic Con, at C2E2. And ultimately, by the end of C2E2, we got the word that, yeah, no, it's not happening. And so the artist who, the very uber realistic artist who was going to do the book, well, no one was going to be paying him. So that all fell apart. And so this friend, this fellow creator on Facebook just went, well, I'm publishing through this little indie company and they're treating me really well. Would you like me to put, you know, connect with them? And I said, yeah, sure. And so we started the discussion and then, oh, okay, they want to recommend artists. And it was a lot of aspiring, what you would expect of indie artists. And I went, we're not going to go from like Marvel DC level. And I'm reluctant to use any terminology here.
Yeah, I know what you mean, though.
Yeah, basically all the art that was being presented to me as potential samples from the publisher. And I went, we're not going to have this level. And then they presented this one guy, it's a South American artist, Samir Samal. And he was amazing. He was an incredible, worthy inheritor of the design that Victor Santos had laid out for us. And so they signed him aboard and I wrote the opening six pages. He drew the teaser. We got it colored, lettered. And we did a Kickstarter in, I guess at this point, it was 2018. We did a Kickstarter and I'd never done a Kickstarter before. And it was not my Kickstarter. It was the publisher's Kickstarter for my book. And I said, like, shouldn't we have as like the upper tiers, like you're committing to issue one, but what about issue two and issue three? Should we have as a tier the collected edition? Like let's do all the, and
Bryan,
the
only time I ever had a Kickstarter not work for us was when the publisher wanted to do it for us.
Mm-hmm.
Every other one we've succeeded, and it's just, I don't want to get into why. Never mind why. Never. I think you know why, but
yep.
Yeah.
I will not continue the tale because it has a very familiar ending. And well, so
if you ever want to dive in yourself, if you've done it or if you haven't done before, we can definitely talk to you about how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I think you've got something here. I mean, people are hungry for this kind of thing. The books that are succeeding right now, I just wish they really were hungry for occult noir stories about detectives, but
no, I would promote that.
Well, no, we actually did a Kickstarter for that. Did two editions. It did very, very well, actually. It's just not doing superhero numbers.
Yeah. Hey, it paid for the printing.
Yay.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Sorry, I just started getting so.
We did it in bulk, so got mass printing done. So I've got a garage full of them.
I just got the message. Yep, message received. I'm just going on and on and on and on.
No, this is all very interesting and extremely fascinating.
We'd love to have you on again. I mean, the audience has really enjoyed this too. I don't know if you've been following the chat. They've been into this.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah, all I have seen have been the couple of questions that have actually popped up on the screen. I don't know where I am technically to follow like whatever it is you guys are receiving.
Oh, okay.
No, our audience is loving hearing your stories and hearing about your books.
Thank you all for being so patient with my blabbering on and on and on and on.
But yeah, we could bring you back sometime anytime you want to hang out with us. We've got kind of an open invite. The way that we do the show is we try to space them out where it's interview, topic, interview, topic.
Mm-hmm.
And if you ever want to do a topic show with us,
yeah,
or come back on to sell your book some more. Well, okay, quickly before we end the night.
Yeah.
Do you have another project in the works?
Oh, well, again, here's where we enter the realm of like what I can or cannot talk about. I have written a novel that is currently being assessed by a publisher right now. It's the very first publisher that gets the chance to say yay or nay. But let me give the micro. It's a sci-fi horror saga. It's intended to be a multi-book saga. Mm-hmm. For now, I'm calling it Bryan J.L. Glass's Dark Spaces. And you don't have to wait for the book itself to come out. You can literally go to YouTube, and if you enter into the search Bryan with a Y, Bryan J.L. Glass's Dark Spaces, you will be able to hear the opening third of the prose novel read by me with music. Imagine my voice right now. My voice talking right now, dramatically, but with music behind me.
Okay, wait. I'm going to ask.
Yes.
Is this the project where aliens invade and suddenly vampires and werewolves and all the creatures of the night say, hey, they're taking our food?
No, that is the devils, you know, and it's not literally vampires and werewolves. It's more like spirits of the supernatural that have been preying upon humanity for eons. That's the devils, you know, and that's a whole other story that involves legendary comics and China and all sorts of, yeah, yes, there's a reason that book never saw the light of day. But yeah, so how I briefly, thank you. How I briefly describe Bryan J.L. Glass's Dark Spaces, at least with this first book, you could imagine it as the apocryphal novel H.P. Lovecraft's Dune.
Oh. I am sold.
So if H.P. Lovecraft had written Dune, that's my first book in the BJLG's Dark Spaces saga. The subtitle is Desolation's Tears. And we could have a whole topic on Dark Spaces, but I know we're running out of time. Thank you.
Well, you know what? Let's bring you back on to talk about that then.
Yeah,
I will be thrilled. Yeah,
my last series, as I said, which actually did well, it just didn't do superhero well, was Case File Arkham, which it was if Raymond Chandler wrote Lovecraft stories.
Ooh.
And so I think we can swap stories there.
Yeah.
Okay.
But before we go, do all this stuff we're supposed to say, Kat.
So once again, tell everybody where they can find you on the interweb, on your personal websites, places they can purchase your books, on social media. Where can people find you?
Ho, let's rattle all this off. I am Bryan with a Y. Bryan with a Y, J.L. Glass. I am on Facebook. I am on Twitter, BJLG, at BJLG on Twitter. I'm on Instagram. I am on YouTube with the Dark Spaces audio. My literary works are available on Amazon. You can also order them at bjlgonline.com. That's my own store. If you order from there, it literally comes out of my basement, full of my basement puke stench, but I'll sign it. what else? I'm bryanjlglass.com. I'm everywhere. You can't escape me if you know where I'm found. Otherwise, you'd never know I was there.
And links for all of this are in the description. And tonight, because why the heck not, I will promote my own novella right now, prose, Scars, which is the superversive story about a fallen astronaut and his helper, hyper-intelligent rat. It's the best uplifting buddy story you'll never expect.
Yes.
Ooh. Somewhere between, what, A Boy and His Dog and, I don't know, something.
I will need to experience that before I come on again so that I can say wonderful things about your work as well. Or at least engage you in meaningful conversation of substantive value.
Do you have a Kindle?
No, I don't.
Oh, okay. I could send you a free copy if you had a Kindle, but anyway, we'll talk about it later.
Yeah, we can finagle all that, and so we will make it happen, my friend.
Definitely. All right, everyone. Thank you for joining us.
Yes, thank you so much, Brian, for joining us this evening. Thank you, everyone in the chat, and thank you, everyone who shared a question. And I hope everyone has a wonderful evening.
Good night.
Take care, all.